Paltrocast.
T Murph, my first question to you is, do I call you T Murph, T Murr? What do you like to be called?
Murph is fine.
Murph it is. Murph, when did you get the role in Woke compared to being allowed to say you got the role in Woke?
I believe I booked Woke either October or November of, well, end of October of 2019. End of October of 2019. And then we shot the pilot end of January, beginning of February of 2020. Wait, I think we shot the pilot in 2019. So it might have been 2018. 2018 is when I booked it. We shot the pilot in 2019.
That's a long time.
Got the show in 2020.
So yeah. when you were doing stand-up gigs, when did you start putting in your intro that the comedian before you would have to say, you've seen this gentleman on the show? Did that not happen until like 6 months ago, or were you doing that in 2018, 2019?
Well, I didn't start doing that until 2020, after the show actually aired. So September when it aired, because right after the show, we finished filming season one, the world shut down.
Right.
So they were editing the entire time, and then things started to open back up towards the end of 2020. The show dropped, and then I was still touring. So, you know, I would go and do shows at the Laugh Factory, and then people had seen it. And so now it's like I'm no longer T Murph, I'm Clovis now. It's like, oh wait, you that dude from Hulu. I'm like, oh, okay, I don't even have a name anymore. I'm just that dude from Hulu.
That dude from Hulu. That sounds like your third comedy special.
That dude.
You're welcome. Well, so you're a great actor, but was the plan all along to be a comic and acting fell in your lap, or did you want to be an actor first?
Well, initially when I was growing up, I never thought about doing comedy. It wasn't something that I even, you know, considered. But I always took like drama classes in high school. I did theater when I was younger. I would go up to Piven School of Theater in Evanston, Illinois. I was in plays. So, but again, I didn't know. I didn't think I would be an actor. It was just something I thought was fun. And, you know, comedy kind of fell in my lap. And I started doing stand-up and fell in love with that. And got a manager, you know, got the agent, all that stuff from the stand-up side of the game. And then they started sending me these auditions. And it was just a tool that I needed to sharpen up a little bit again. And here we are.
Were you able to work when you lived in Chicago? And by that, I mean, nowadays you could live in any state.
Yes.
And because it's not like it's just a New York, LA industry anymore. And nowadays there's a lot happening in Chicago. Like every damn procedural show is now filmed in Chicago. Were you able to work when you were an Illinois guy?
Yeah. So I'm still in Chicago. I never left. So, you know, I've done plenty of productions here. And then when I am needed to do things in Los Angeles, they'll fly me out, or New York or Atlanta or Vancouver or whatever. Because as you know, nobody's going in the room to audition anymore. All of this stuff is on tape. So why would I move somewhere and pay three times the rent for a studio when I can have a house in Chicago? So it's like, I prefer the house.
With mentioning Chicago and your roots in stand-up and acting alongside that, did Second City play into any of that?
No. So actually, I never attended any classes in Second City. Like the only like actual training I had was when I went to Piven School of Theater. I took some college level courses of theater at SIU, but yeah, that was really it. I've done stand up in Second City, you know,
right.
I've done Breakout Fest there for a couple of years, but I've never done any classes or conservatory classes there or anything.
Conservatory is a pretty big word. I don't even try and say it in my everyday life. So good on you. But when exactly did this feel like a career to you? What, because like the part you had in Key and Peele, now we know that is like a life-changing career-making show. But it wasn't that way in like 2012 when you were cast in that.
Yeah. When I filmed Comic View. So I was maybe 2 years into stand-up, and then I booked that. And like, that was the thing that I grew up watching. And that's when I realized, I was like, yo, I can do this. You know, I'm making strangers laugh. I've got, mm-hmm. you know, I've got casting directors booking me for TV shows. And then I started doing colleges right around 2014, 2015, and they were paying pretty good money. And I was just, I could probably do this for real. So yeah, once you book that first TV gig, you're like, this is my job now.
ComicView gave the world so many excellent comics. Alonzo Hamburger Jones being one of them,
Yes.
of course.
Hamburger.
That never gets old. But was that what kind of opened up the doors for you in comedy, that one appearance there?
So yeah, for me, that appearance there actually helped me meet a lot of comics that live in Los Angeles. So Sydney Castilla, who is still a great friend of mine, I met Sydney filming that. Who is now he's one of the head writers on a show on HBO. He's wrote for the Emmys. He's wrote for the Oscars. James Davis, I met him there. A comedian named by the name of D-Lay. Lil Rel filmed that when I filmed it. Ron G. Kevin Hart was there when we filmed. He was just like starting to take off. He wasn't filming ComicView, but he was coming to watch a few of his friends that now tour with him. Naeem Lynn and Spank Horton, like all of these dudes I met on that production. And that started to kind of build a little incubator, if you will, of comics. To Ray Gordon out of Philly. I started touring, doing all of these different comics that I named. I started doing their shows. And then they started to plug me with other productions that were going on while I was in Los Angeles. Hey, man, Murph, I don't have time to do this. You want to go do this production? Oh, yeah, I'll go do that.
All
And
right.
that's how it happened, man.
The guy works. Well, hey, bring it back to woke here because Team Woke said, hey, that's how you're going to get to talk to Team Murph. You're not big enough otherwise to speak with Team Murph. Favorite moment or highlight? Do you have one of those kinds of stock answers to like, this was the best part of being part of the show?
Really, the best part of being a part of the show for me is working with Lamorne, Sashir, and Blake. They are extremely talented, seasoned actors, and for me to be able to, you know, be the new guy and be welcomed by these individuals or these actors, if you will. It man, it was it's it was dope for me. And I love the experience. And it's also it was it's super easy to grow in that environment and become better. Like a lot of times, you know, when you meet people, they're not who they seem to be, you know, on TV or whatever. But no, these three are just dope. Our director, Maurice Marable. Keith Knight, the creator, Marshall, everybody is just so cool.
Cool. Well, Sashir, to her credit, I admire her reinvention of her career because for a lot of people, being on SNL for a season or two would be the footnote that they use for the rest of their life. And I think most people don't even realize that she was on SNL. Now, looking at your credits, like Key and Peele, that's nothing compared to what you've done. So it's really great to see how you've evolved and grown as a performer. And that's not a question, that's a compliment. So you're going to take it, right?
Thank you.
So are you allowed to say what's next, or is woke everything? It's all woke and all stand-up gigs.
Well, no, I mean, right now, woke is what's, you know, we're doing season, you know, we just finished season two. It's about to come out. Hopefully there'll be a season three, but you know, there's other things in the work. Right now, I'm touring and working and building out this hour because that's my next thing, you know, filming my stand-up special so that people can really get an opportunity to know me as more than just that guy from Hulu.
That guy from Hulu. And as we wind down here, my last question, which is totally putting you on the spot, who is the best musical artist of all time in the eyes of Murph?
Kanye West.
Really? Is that because you're a Chicago guy?
No, I am like a complete Kanye stan. His music, I was in college when the College Dropout came out. So from College Dropout, Late Registration, Graduation, 808s and Heartbreak, like my Dark Twisted Fantasy, like I am a Kanye West stan. And I mean, he just makes great music. He makes great music, and I don't feel like anybody else has ever had an influence like he's had on the world when it comes to music. You know, without Kanye West, there could be no Drake because there was no space for him to exist in rap. Because at one point, you only had super gangster rappers, you had dudes who were talking about selling drugs. And the next thing you know, you got this guy with a pink polo and
backpacks
and a backpack talking about out of college. And he becomes the biggest artist the world has ever seen. Like, it's insane. So, yeah. Well,
I am so delighted to have spoken with you. Looking forward to what's next and hope to see one of those gigs in New York in the near future, man.
Definitely. Thank you so much, Darren. Paltrocast.